Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all to the Passive Design and Shading webinar today. I am Yashima Jain, and I'll be moderating today's webinar session. This is the third technical session of the 10-part series, and we hope that you have got the chance to review the self-learning modules on today's topic. Next slide, please. Now, before we begin, I would like to acknowledge the support of our sponsors and affiliates. Next. Today's session is being conducted by architect Siddharth Wig. Siddharth is a partner at The Elements, which focuses on socially relevant, cost-effective, and energy-efficient architecture. He has been a visiting faculty at TVB School of Habitat Studies, New Delhi, and Chandigarh College of Architecture, and IIT Bhadal for their undergraduate and graduate programs. He has taught subjects including energy efficient architecture, climatology, environmental psychology, ecological planning, and low cost building. We welcome you, Siddharth. Now, before we actually begin the session, let's go through some administrative stuff for this week. First, some of you have contacted us and said that you are still looking for project partners. Now, as your decision on project partners might affect your choice on your competition division, and to help you with that, we are allowing you to change your competition division until October 7th. Now, the portal will remain closed, but in case you want to update, you can send us an email and we can help you with that. Also, we have shared a form with your team leads and faculty leads. And if you need any help in finding a project partner, please fill up that form and share it with us by October 3. Also, the deadline to submit the required documents for your design builder licenses has been extended to October 11. So in case you still have not given your documents, this is your last chance to get hold of the design builder license. And that's about the announcements that was supposed to be made. We will start now. Also, as always, you are free to send in your questions at any time during the session. We will take as many questions as time allows during the session, and we will provide answers to the unanswered questions in a write-up later on. Please remember to type in your questions in the Q&A window and not in the chat window. And with that, it's over to you, Siddharth.
Thank you, Yashima. Good afternoon, everybody. I will be talking about passive design and shading today. A lot of it is going to be my personal experience and how I have gone through the process of design. I want to start by showing you what is happening all around. You're all aware. I don't think this is what sustainable architecture should be. Energy guzzling glass boxes devoid of character, no respect for site or user, and it's a shame on most of the architects who end up doing work like this. This is something that we should be striving to achieve, which is something which is more relevant, something which is more contextual, which uses a local skill set, which uses local materials. And in order to get to all this, we are trying to look at a more passive way to build. So the way I approach a design problem is what I want to take you through. Most of the initial slides are a little bland because I just want to run you through these. I want to concentrate on the case studies because that's where most of the gyan will actually come out. One question that often comes up in my mind is the difference between function and performance. Often we end up writing specifications for function. We have been trying over years to look at and concentrate on the performance fit of the building. How does a building form? How does the various facets of the building, whether it's the envelope, the roof, the windows, perform? And I'm looking at what is the essential in a building. That comes first, and then we look at the nice to haves. Comfort is what we are designing most of where we will live, design these buildings for. And the comfort I am looking at as thermal comfort, visual comfort, and importantly, psychological comfort also. This is a graph I'm sure that most of you have seen. The varying climatic factors, the topmost or the outermost dark green is what the natural conditions are. There is a lot of variations that are there. And by doing control at the settlement level, at the planning level, we're able to do some kind of microclimatic controls and lower the impact of the climatic factors. By structural controls in buildings, you're able to bring it still closer. Eventually, mechanical controls is what is needed, but I want to look at that in a little bit more detail. But this lecture today, we will try to concentrate on the microclimatic and the structural controls. This has been very aptly put in this three-tier system that you've already looked at in your earlier studies. I forget the module that you're looking at, the self-learning module. In that, this is given. The first two are very, very important, and that is what we look at, the basic building design and the passive systems, where you're using the natural potential of site, you're using the natural energies that are available, the natural sinks that are available to you at site. All of you are familiar with the modes of heat transfer, the basic concept of how conduction, convection, radiation actually take place, the different definitions, thermal mass, everything. So I'm not going to get into that. But understanding comfort is something that I want you to look at in a little bit more detail. You're familiar with the bioclimatic chart that is here. The factors that affect comfort, temperature, humidity, are the same, the air movement, are the same that are affecting climate, weather. But in our case, how does this affect human comfort? It's important to understand that before we go into designing of buildings. It's important to understand that it's not a value. It is a range that you're looking at. Whether you look at the psychometric chart, whether you look at the bioclimatic zone, in this case also, you're looking at a zone. And to arrive at that zone, there could be various ways. There could be various strategies in which you could arrive at that zone. Also, I think it's important to look at adaptive comfort. Fergus Nichols did a lot of work in this field. It's not a uniform value or a uniform range that has to be applied. What we are doing, what clothes we are wearing, what activity we are engaged in, whether we have personal controls over the over controlling our microenvironment, all go a long way in determining our feeling of comfort. So it's not just a uniform comfort, it's a feeling of comfort that we are looking at. So it's not just the temperature, but would also mean the freshness of air that is there in that space that makes us feel more comfortable. How do we understand what the task at hand is? So I often go about overlaying site conditions with comfort expectation. And I want to look at this in detail when I'm looking at the case studies there. As a result of overlaying the site conditions, so site conditions would mean everything that the site is giving you, and you're overlaying that with what your expectation from comfort will be. How much of that can be achieved by what is available to you at site? And as a result of this, you arrive at a strategy, or strategies more likely. Now the basic tools for this, you will either need to cool or heat or ventilate or to control the humidity in the building. And we require to look at all these aspects. Most of the time, if you're looking at one as a priority over the other, would work, but one has to be careful because the combined effect of all of them is what we will eventually look at. And in order to do this, one needs to understand how our flow of energy, how our flow of heat is happening. The way I've been looking at whether it's energy, whether it is water, is to look at the quality of that energy, quality of the heat that is required, the quantity, the quantum that is required, at what time of the day, at what time of the year is it required, and for how long. The moment this is identified, it makes it easier for you to respond. How do you start responding to sight? Of course, your latitude, your solar geometry will depend on your latitude, your altitude will make a lot of difference in terms of the rarity of the air, the kind of shadows that will be cast, topography, landscape. These are all the basic things that you are anyway looking at when you're responding to sight. Based on this, your initial set of strategies will be formed. Where are you going to locate your building on site? What are the parameters that are going to determine? Often in smaller sites, it's the edging of the site that is dictating the location of the building. In larger sites, perhaps you can get away by choosing your solar geometry, choosing your topography, choosing features, geographical features at site, which would help you to locate. The orientation of the building, very, very important again. Your shadows, your amount of heat gain, your amount of heat loss, your amount of ventilation will all depend on the orientation of the building. And often, more important than orientation of the building is orientation of your windows. The openings that are actually going to allow either solar ingress or heat coming in or ventilation that is happening. Orientation of the windows could be different from orientation of the building, as we will also see in some of our case studies. Then you can play with shadows, whether it is intra-building shadows or inter-building shadows. Most courtyards, most spaces, interstitial spaces that are created are very comfortable simply because shadows from the building can be created and used very, very effectively. The building envelope, perhaps the most major, the most important thing. This will include the thermal mass, this will include the composition, the materials that you're using, the U values, how the building shape is being done will all affect the total amount of heat gain, heat loss, or ventilation that you're trying to achieve. The roof. Sometimes we feel that the roof and the building envelope are static things. But the fact is that over the year, the amount of radiation that is falling on these will vary. So it's important to understand. Again, for example, in the climate that we are at, say in Chandigarh, you will realize that the south face is getting more winter sun, but the amount of radiation that's coming out of the wall, out of the four walls and the roof, the maximum is happening on the south wall in the case of winter sun. But in case of summer, the south wall is no longer the most affected thing. The roof all of a sudden becomes more affected. So your strategies need to depend after you understand all this. And then comes planning and layout strategies. How you want your building spacing to happen, which will allow for better daylighting inside the building, how it will allow for ventilation. So cooling strategies, primarily what you're trying to do is to reduce heat gain and to increase heat loss. There are some standard things that we've been looking at. Insulation, of course. But besides pure insulation, it's important to understand the value of depreciation and time lag. Insulation, depreciation, time lag could also give you contradictory results. For example, for a sleeping room in a composite climate at night, you may have a thin outer wall, which will have a lot of heat gain during the day, but will quickly lose heat also to make the inside more comfortable. Also, you may end up with a much larger, much thicker wall with a greater thermal mass, which will allow for a lot of the outside heat not to come in, thus giving you comfort conditions inside. So at times there may be a variation of options, a variation of strategies that you could apply for achieving the same level of comfort. Thermal mass, again, important for you to understand, the thermal mass will hold on to the mass. It can be used for cooling and also for heating. Evaporative cooling, presence of water, availability of water is important, but evaporative cooling works very well. We've used it in a variety of ways, whether it is for misting or for simple evaporative cooling within the space directly. Earth coupling, so whether it is berming, whether your window is, whether your building is set into the ground, different ways in which earth coupling can happen. Earth coupling can be achieved in, I would say, in a lot of different climatic zones, but you've got to be careful because there could be construction, buildability, and maintenance issues in this. Available heat sinks, the sky, presence of a large water body are all potential areas around that you can look at as available heat sinks. Ventilation, again, is a very viable cooling strategy, and we looked at that in detail. Microclimatic manipulations are possible using landscape, using a lot of transpiration from plants, looking at deciduous trees that could shed trees in winter, shed leaves in winter, and allow for shading to happen during summer. For heating strategies, the idea is to increase the heat gain, decrease heat loss. This can be done by direct gain, where the sun is directly coming into the building, indirect gain, where it's happening in another part of the building, say a wall is getting hot and that heat is then being transferred into the building. Alternatively, isolated gain is also possible. There's a lot of potential in isolated gain and we often miss out on this potential. You can gain heat from a different part of site that is getting exposed to sun, especially for say cold, cloudy kind of climates. Your main building may not be oriented or facing the sun, but it's possible for another area of site to get isolated gain and then use that into your building. You may need a working fluid for that though. Air is a possibility. Water, of course, is also there. And then the idea is to control your losses. Now, controlling losses depends on how well you're able to detail out the building. In heating strategies, in a tromb wall, all of you are familiar with the basic tromb wall, in that the openings are not there. You have a glass, you have a thick wall, often which is painted black, you have a sun or the rays which are coming in. The wall gets heated. The hot air comes into the room. It forms a loop. The cold air comes in. And this is a good example of how indirect gain can take place. Now, there can be so this is a basic wall, but you can do variations on this also. Now, if you look at the openings 1, 2, 3, and 4. So in case it is very hot, what you can do is close openings 3 and 4, allow for the cold air to come in through opening 2 and get out through opening 1. This will allow for the cavity formed by the trombe wall to be ventilated and the heat will not really come into the space. Another variation is possible where you are keeping opening 2 closed and through opening 4. So you are having a lower opening on the other end of the room, through a courtyard, through an area where there is a lot of greenery. Cold air is coming in from here. It is entering to the bottom of the trombe wall. The hot air is rising and it is getting out. So the trombe wall is serving as a way to evacuate hot air and cold air is coming in. Sorry, this is a repeat of... Okay, I look at the trombe wall in detail because I want to get into the detail of solar chimneys also and see how ventilation can be done using that. cross ventilation in plan, in section, in building layout. Again, I'm not getting into these in details because in your self-learning modules and in subsequent lectures, you're going to get into these in a lot of detail. I want to look at a solar chimney and see how that can help in aiding forced ventilation. We've used solar chimney in a lot of our projects. The one on the top left that you see is one of the first projects that we did. This was a residence in Panchkula. We did it in 1997. The solar chimney you see here was a very initial attempt. It was made out of single layer of black stone. The idea was that it will get hot, the hot air will rise, and out of three rooms in the house, two rooms in the ground floor, one room on the first floor, the hot air was being evacuated. It was partly successful, not too great, but worked. Then the image on the right you see, this was a 200 kilowatt solar power plant control room building that we did for PEDA. Three chimneys that you see, these were evacuating all the hot air from the equipment rooms inside. This was a more conventional solar chimney facing south. It had glazing, it had black internal metal cased walls, and the outside was also black. And the air was coming out at a little height from the slab. I remember going on a winter or a morning in November and standing here and putting my hand up even at 9 a.m. in the morning. There was sufficient draft that was being formed. The cool air was coming in from the outside here. The cool air was coming in into the building. The hot air, the rooms were connected into the building at this point where you see these fan lights. At this level, the hot air was being funneled into the solar chimney. The bottom left image is an orphanage that we designed. And this also, these are the rooms for the children. And we again used a solar chimney here. Now these are three completely different uses. And in the case studies today, you will see three other completely different ways to use a solar chimney. The solar chimney uses a very basic principle. Glass has this peculiar property where it allows shortwave radiation to come in, doesn't allow long wave radiation to pass. And the radiation is a function, the wavelength is a function of the temperature of the body. So like you see in a car in winter, where the rays of the sun are coming in, since the sun is at a higher temperature, short wave radiation goes through the glass, makes the car hot. Now the car is at a much lower temperature, long wave radiation, it can't get through, it gets trapped. So the same principle, it's the trapped air, the hot air, which is forced to rise, and you can use it for natural forced ventilation. For humidity control strategies, again, the choice of material. Often we've used mud or a variation of mud without with very little cement on the walls to allow it to breathe a bit. You can have phase change materials that actually change their phase depending on the temperature, and then it could change back by releasing that heat. You can have desiccants, which are very popular. You can have a desiccant wheel. Again, some amount of energy is used, and therefore these would come under the category of the desiccants. A desiccant wheel would come under the category of a hybrid system. In hybrid systems, again, isolated heat gain loss. Lot of variations can be done in this. I remember doing a project up in Shimla where we were able to collect heat from the roof. We were able to heat water and transport that water throughout the building, and we had radiators in every room. And that hot water circulating in the radiators was able to give us good, decent, ambient warmth. Earth-air tunnels, we'll look at it in one of the case studies today. I'm sure you're all familiar with the principle, the 4 or 5 meters below the earth, the temperature is at the annual mean, which means that in summer it's much colder, in winter it's much warmer, and that can be used. There are some inherent problems in earth air tunnels, like rodents, vermin. Also the friction there gets to be difficult, and often you need a large amount of energy to blow air through. Tracking devices. These could be used for something like optical daylighting, where you're able to channelize, make sure that concentrated light or concentrated heat is falling in a part of your choice. Okay, so you could have a variety of strategies then that you're looking at how to integrate active systems into these strategies, but we look at, this hasn't come out clearly. What I wanted to say was that the combined effect is lower than the sum of the individual parts. So often when you're looking at the individual strategies, these may look very effective individually, but the moment you combine them, the net effect may not be the same. Looking at case studies, I have four projects that I have looked at. The Institute for Rural Research and Development, Gurgaon, done by Mr. Ashok Lal. Retreat, the new Terry campus, done by Sanjay Prakash. Apsara Academy, done by Case in Bombay. And Akshay Urja Bhavan, which has been done by our office here. So the IRRD at Gurgaon is quite an epic building, because the moment you look at it, you realize that the kind of shading devices that have been used are quite innovative. They are made out of lightweight material. They are not touching the building, they are coming out. They form an aesthetic sense also, but they are serving a useful purpose. It's a 5,000 square meter building, RCC frame, but it used a lot of interesting features. A lot of earth that was taken out from the basement is what was used in making the stabilized earth blocks. They managed to lower the overall CO2 footprint drastically. They were using wood instead of aluminium. They were using no fired brick, no imported stone was used. So the overall embodied energy as well as the CO2 component was drastically reduced. The building is using a lot of the orientation. After the orientation, they've used ways in which the windows are designed. There is radiant cooling happening inside. There are radiant beams running through the building, which is a far more effective way to do, because you're not using the volume of air that is normally required to run through a building. So it saves on the air conditioning cost, on the initial capital cost of the building also. In this building, they were able to achieve nearly 35 to 40% lower cost, as well as higher in the energy efficiency for the air conditioning system. If you look at the section, you see that the controls, the shading devices are placed a little distance away. So even any heat gain that is done on the devices itself is not transferred to the building. The buildings were insulated from the external environment. Of course, that reduced the amount of cooling load. The windows were planned in a way that there was external shading on them. The insulation on the roof, the PV insulation, also helped to insulate the roof area. The internal courtyard that was formed was good, because it had louvers on top, and that aided in providing a cooler area from which cool air was coming into the building. The roof had a high SRI reflective paint on the roof, which made the roof less contributing to the amount of heat that was coming into the building. The landscape was again a very, very important part. The kind of plants that were chosen, they got in an expert where they were looking at native species. They were looking at the kind of shadows that would be formed. They were looking at the transpiration rates and the amount of coolth, the potential of the coolth that the transpiration would provide. These are some views from the building. Again, choice of local materials, the kind of wood, soil block, civilized soil block that was used, local stone was used. This is what it looks like from the outside. The solar panels on the roof providing complete energy, also providing shade for the roof. look at the way the external shades have been done. So completely the regular chajja has been removed in this case. And we've come up with a very interesting aesthetic way to deal with the problem of providing shade. This is the courtyard. This is the internal courtyard. You see the BIPV on the top through which diffused light is coming in. Okay. The next case study is on the retreat building at Gwalpahari, the new Terry campus done by Sanjay Prakash. This is a slightly smaller building. It was finished nearly two decades ago, but it's still working very, very effectively. They did benchmarking initially, looked at if whatever the conventional lighting load would have been, how to reduce it. They did benchmarking for wastewater management, for the amount of pure energy that they would be using. And they looked at a variety of ways in which to reduce the demand for energy. Once the demand for energy is reduced, then they were looking at alternate ways to generate that energy from site also. So the roof was insulated with vermiculite. It had China mosaic on the top to increase the amount of reflection. There was expanded polystyrene in the walls. The part of the building was sunken into the ground, the east and the west. Again, understand that this is composite climate in Delhi. So the east and west often gets difficult because of the low sun, which still is quite penetrative. The shading devices were properly designed. The landscape again was looked at with deciduous trees to allow for winter sun to come in, keeping the summer sun blocked. But the important feature here was one, the insulation. Two, they went in with a earth air tunnel. There were four tubes of 70 meters each, which eventually was aided by a solar chimney to draw the hot air out. So it was a composite system. There was two HP fans that were blowing in the air, and it worked for, I think, nearly a decade and a half. And now they have added a 5-ton air conditioning unit at the end of the earth air tunnel to improve the quality of conditioned space inside the buildings. That is the earth air tunnel. It's important to see, once you had reduced the amount of energy that was required, they were then using a gas-based ammonia chiller. They were also using a gasifier using biomass, which was generated at site. And of course, there was a solar hot water system. What I found interesting in this was that it wasn't inclined at the conventional angle at which you would do it in Delhi. The architect in this case decided to have it far more vertical. And in discussions, I realized that one, it increases the effectiveness in terms of the space usage. He was able to use it on the elevation. Two, maintenance becomes easier because the angle of the glass becomes more vertical. There is less dust that settles on it, and therefore maintenance becomes easier. Yes, the amount of heat being generated was less, but then the amount of heat that was required for the amount of water requirement, they were able to fulfill that. Look at the solar chimneys now. You saw three earlier solar chimneys which were used in a different way. Here the solar chimney are these darker inclined chimneys on the south face. They're a little darker in color. They are inclined, so they are bigger at the bottom, the cross section, and smaller at the top. And most of the active heat being provided is by a little curved black metal plate on the top, which is collecting the heat, and the heat is then coming out. Of course, the air is being forced into these rooms by the 2-horsepower fans I mentioned through the earth air tunnels. There's cool air that's coming in, and the hot air is then allowed or being forced to escape through these solar chimneys. These are the panel, the hot water panels that I mentioned at 70 degrees that you see. You can see the solar chimney here. The solar chimney is actually narrower on the top, is wider at the bottom. We made it darker in color to allow for more heat gain. So this was made out of ferrocement. There was a 20 mm ferrocement panel on which this red stone is pasted. The design aesthetic that comes out as a result of these is very interesting. I am not so sure as to the amount of heat that these little black metal plates on the top were able to generate. I've never tried it like this, but Sanjay was confident that yes, it works and works well. This is what it is looking like from the outside. These are some of the ponds for the water purification system. Complete solar, it was using solar and the biomass gasifier. They were able to completely meet their energy needs. This is what the building looks like from the front. So it's a little concave on the north face, and the south face is which has all the solar chimneys you saw. The atrium again has BIPV. I think it's also important to use BIPV where you want to show that solar panels are being used, especially for an experiential part of the building. Okay. The third project I want to look at is the Apsara Academy at Pune. This is an interesting example because it has very simple RCC column and beam construction as the basis of the regular design. And the aesthetic that is coming out is also from that. It's almost Corbusian in its portrayal. This is the plan, you see. North is in this direction. These are the three main teaching blocks. That's for Indian Studies, Science, Engineering, Center for Entrepreneurship. This is the highest point of sight, the water kind of flows, and this is the lowest point where after the reed beds and all, the wastewater is all collected and used for horticulture there. The buildings are spaced apart to allow for ventilation. And if you look at the plans in detail, you realize that they're very open plans. They allow for a lot of ventilation. They allow for a lot of natural light to come in. The image on the right that you see, the glazing is on all sides. They are using the bamboo panels, which are of three densities all around the building. They're using it to cover their pipes. They don't have any shafts in this case. They're using it as protection from summer sun. They are also using it as a design aesthetic in this case. So this is what the plan looks like. And if you look carefully on the in the middle of the plan, on all the floors, you have a shaft. And they've used it in an interesting way. So they have a solar chimney, which is in the middle of the building. We have large glazings on all sides. You have a lot of openness to allow for cool air to come in. There are large 1 meter Hume pipes which are put under the building to allow for cool air to enter. And this feeds, this cools under the floor. Also, there is air inlet under the sill level on the ground floor. There is cool air that is coming into the building. The hot air is rising through the chimney. And on the roof, you have a solar chimney top, which is glazed, which is black inside, having the hot air, and it allows the hot air to force the ventilation through this. It's interesting, and it would be interesting to look at post-occupancy studies of something like this also. A solar chimney which is able to generate so heat that this is generated. I'll show you some images of what the chimney is looking like from the bottom. Very interesting roof shapes also are coming out there. A lot of waste tiles, waste stone was used. You can see it in the flooring here. So these on the top that you see, this is a water tank and a little storeroom. This is a mumti for the staircase. And you will, so here are the bamboo panels that you see on all sides there. No, there. So this is the top of the solar chimney. So that is facing south now. It collects the heat and it's pulling out the air now from all the rooms. So all these three buildings, the first three buildings that you see, are similar in design. And as I was mentioning, almost Corbusian in its outlook. Very open spaces, a lot of air to come in, a lot of natural light that comes in. Inside the rooms, they are looking at ventilation happening. A lot of these top panels are openable. So they open the top panels. Let me see if I can get a view of that. Yeah. So here, you can see some of the top panels that open up here to allow for ventilation into these spaces. So you see how the potential of sight, how the potential of climate has been used in order to achieve a level of comfort. The last project I want to look at is in a little bit more details. This is a project that we were involved with. It's the Akshay Urja Bhavan, the Hareda building for Hareda in Panchkula. It was a 1 acre site. The total build-up area was to be about 5,500 square meters. It was a national competition. The brief was very interesting. They said it should not be connected to the electricity grid or water grid at all. So the idea was to come up with a net zero building for water and energy. We started by looking at a little benchmarking figure as to what would be the amount of energy consumption for a building of this kind. And for a conditioned building, it was coming to about 90, the EPI, 90 kilowatt hours per square meter per year. And for passive low energy buildings, it was about 30. So this was a basic benchmark that we were starting with. The site was nearly a square site, a little rectangular. The advantage was that it was open on three sides. So we had the east, the south, and the west that was open. North was slightly inclined. Besides this, there was a little bit of common area. Then there was a big road, and after the road was another common area, and then lower residential buildings. So we had a completely unhindered south face that we were getting. So how the evolution of design happened, this was the site. And we looked at that, yes, south is important. How do we maximize the south exposure in this case? We could have oriented the building according to site, but then just a horizontal shade would have been difficult because there would have been a lot of angular sun coming in from the west, would have been difficult to control. So that was one criteria. We wanted to keep our axis as close to the north-south axis as possible. And we were able to maintain it in this case at about 7 degrees or so. Then we looked at what the potential of site would be. This was the area which the sun was going to be high in summer and comfortable in winter. The east and the west areas would have been difficult to control. North, a lot of light was available. Sun was not really so much of a problem. So we looked at increasing the south face. So from a regular rectangle, we increased the south face. The east and the west, we actually shrunk inside. So we lowered the direct impact of the east and west onto the east and west face by inclining it inside towards north. Then we introduced a courtyard within this. As a result of this evolution, some interesting things happened at site. One, the entrance opened it up, which made the 1 acre site actually look much bigger than what it is. Two, we were able to get areas on the site which could be used for service, for maintenance, which were easy to access. And from there, we were able to get our light and ventilation also. This side was the Election Commission office, again, which had a sufficient setback over here. So light was really not affected. Now, if you see, we had a much longer south face. The east and the west, the projections that you see are windows which we still were able to orient due south. We were able to shut off the east rays. Similarly on the west face, we were able to shut off the direct west sun and we allowed for south sun, south light still to come into the building. So this is how the shape of the building, the location on site was finalized. This is what the eventual site plan looked like. This were the public areas, the parking areas, the central green. There was a place to sit, a little amphitheater that we formed here. This is all the maintenance areas at the back, the courtyard in the middle, and this was the entry into the plot, and this was the entry into the building. So we started by doing a preliminary climate analysis. We looked at the mean hourly temperatures for the year. Since it was a day use building, we looked at a time from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. We looked at January to December. We decided that comfort for us in this case is going to be between 18 to 24. Anything higher than 24, yes, we will need to cool the building. Anything lower than 18, we will need to heat the building. So we realized that the comfort areas were really very little. It was primarily a cooling exercise that we had to do. We looked at the wind speeds again through the day, through the year, looked at how we could use this potential. Again, most of the higher wind was coming in at, or comfortable wind was coming in at a time when we were also occupying the building. So that was good. We could use this to our advantage. We looked at a psychrometric chart. We plotted all the mean daily temperatures along with the humidity, and we arrived at design strategies from January through December as to what was normally comfort, how much of it can be achieved by shading. The moment we arrived at this group of strategies, we knew what would be important or where we needed to prioritize. For example, sun shading all of a sudden turned out to be a big way to solve the problems. Having a high thermal mass, including doing some insulation, evaporative cooling was a good strategy. How to lower the internal heat gain, we looked at. Based on these strategies, and we looked at the relative humidity also. Sorry, this slide should have come earlier. Then we looked at the amount of rainfall that is falling in Chandigarh. And of course, it was 2 months that the majority of the rain was falling. We were looking at about a meter of rainfall in a year, the majority of it was falling. So this was important because we needed to plan our water tank size accordingly. We did detailed studies of how much of water can be collected, what was the water requirement for gardening and domestic in an inefficient and then in an efficient system. And we plotted this. Sorry, this hasn't come. Where we were looking at how to size our tank. It was an 8 lakh liter tank that was arrived at if gray and black water was being recycled. And just for gray water, it was 6.5 lakh liters. And that is eventually the size of the underground tank in the courtyard that we were able to do. So based on this, the simulation was done and we were given a set of advisory things by our consultant. And the important, interesting thing was that the consultant came back and said, you know what, you've been able to achieve so much using passive that very little actually needs to be done in active, only very little tweaking, if at all. So there were some things which had to be done for thermal, there were some things which were done for wind, and there were some things which we were doing for water. Yeah. I look at these strategies in detail. Primarily what we did was we said, yes, it's not a value, it's not even a range, but let us have a variable range throughout the building. So the primary areas, which were going to be the apex offices, the guest rooms, conference areas, etc. We said, yes, these need to be air conditioned and these will be at 25 plus minus one. The less important, the peripheral areas, the other offices, exhibition areas, etc., we agreed on 25 plus minus 3. And the corridors, the workshops, etc., we said can be at 25 plus minus 5. So all of a sudden, from a value, we've given ourselves a range up to from 20 to 30 degrees. And it was interesting because the director at Hareda completely agreed with us when we made this suggestion. This made our strategies also much easier and concentrated. We were looking at misting to happen from March to May, fogging inside the courtyard, which would have worked. There were centrally chilled control spaces and ventilated passive spaces. So as you were moving from a less ventilated to a less conditioned to a more conditioned area, there wasn't real thermal shock also. And we also designed the chilled water system to be set at a much higher temperature. In this case, 15 is what we had suggested. We were looking at earth coupling for water in this case, but it turned out to be too expensive and eventually we had to forego the idea. So now, with all this in mind, let us see how the building shape and building use, the function and the performance actually worked out. So this is what the site plan is looking like. I told you the entrance into the building. This was the courtyard. Let's look at the ground floor. You enter from here. There was a corridor all along the courtyard. This was a workshop area where there was a staircase going into the basement. There were two other primary staircases which were going up, and there was an elevator from the lobby. This is now the south face. These are the solar chimneys you see. So there were five solar chimneys on the south face, and there were two additional solar chimneys which were on the inside the courtyard. These were helping to achieve a natural draft from the toilets. We wanted to ventilate the toilets naturally using the solar chimneys. The less important offices, the staircase, the toilets, the workshop areas were what were put on the east and the west. Major offices were put on the south face. The floor plate was kept narrow so that you could get daylight in from both sides. Same for the north face, where there was a lot of natural light that was coming. For the first floor, this is where the important offices were. Again, most of the offices were coming in here. You can see these were more the store, the elevator, the toilets, some smaller cabins were happening on this face. On the west face was the kitchen, and between the usable areas, we gave a little covered balcony to lower the impact of the east sun there. On the upper floor, Harida also had a mandate to do a lot of regular training. So there was a training multipurpose hall on the top floor, and they had dormitories, they had guest rooms on the top floor, which would feed where people would come and stay, and they would then be using the training room. There was a lot of extra space that was generated initially, but now all of it is used. Initially, the mandated strength was only 55 people. Now it's gone up to 120 odd. This was the basement. You see the large water tank in the basement. The area in the middle is where we decided to plant a large tree inside the courtyard. These are some of the sections you see. The solar chimney, again, using Bernoulli's principle, we had a wider base and a thinner top. The glazing was continuing completely. The insides were painted black. We had shades coming out. Now, these were all designed. This was, remember, this more or less due south. These were designed to allow for winter sun to come in, summer sun to be completely shut off. The complete window was also at a little angle. The louvers on the roof, initially this was supposed to be ferrocement. Eventually we ended up with a metal frame and ACC, the clad sheet, aluminium clad sheet on the top. Again, these were calculated to allow for only winter sun to come in. The summer sun, there would be a diffused light that would come in and give light to the central courtyard. This is a section through. So this is the south face. You see the solar chimneys and the glazing at an angle. These were all shades that were coming out. So the horizontal shades were also providing a maintenance corridor. You would get onto this and you'll be able to go and clean the windows. You didn't need a separate device in order to hang down from the roof into it. The roof of this multipurpose hall was inclined to allow for solar panels to be put directly on them. There was VIPV that we put above the courtyard here also. That's the section. Now let's look at some of the passive features that we've talked about. The orientation of the building, you can see the glazing, you can see the chhajjas, the shades that were done, again, as for maintenance, as well as allowing for winter sun to come in, cutting the summer sun off. There were almost no east or west openings. We had a heat reflective tile with a very high SRI on the roof, where we were able to achieve a net temperature drop of nearly 13 to 15 degrees Celsius there. Some of the views, this is the courtyard before the tree came up. The corners were green walls over here. The louvers on the roof that you can see, the BIPV above the walkway. Totally, we had a 42.5 kilowatts solar power plant. So 37.5 kilowatts was regular and 5 kilowatts BIPV above the corridor. Misting is what we were doing. Misting worked out very well. It worked. We put three lines, one for each floor. So depending on the intensity of coolth required, we were able to use these. It worked so well that often we would hear that they had to shut it off during peak summer in May and June because it would get very, very cold inside the building. One thing we did not take care of was the water that would be generated, the dampness that would be generated as a result of this misting. Often the corridors would become wet and would be a little bit of a hazard. So next time around, we'll probably use less polished flooring on the corridors. You can see the roof. All this is the roof. So you see how reflective it has, a very high albedo there. Solar power panels there. We had a 600 liter solar water heater also for all the dormitories and the guest rooms there. Complete natural light. This is the canteen area. There was a two-pass water system here. All the water from the washing, bathing, cleaning was cleaned up in a grey water recycling unit, and it was then reused using drip irrigation there. We had grasscrete blocks all along. The simulation results showed 15 EPI, kilowatt hours per square meter per year. What we were actually able to achieve when post-occupancy studies were done, and this was corroborated at about 13.7. That's what the plaque is on the lobby of the building. We are a net positive building here. We were able to generate about 5,000 units more than we were consuming in a year. For water, after the first year, they actually shut off the municipal water supply, and that has been the case ever since. We were CO2 positive, but the amount of the volume of that was too little for it really to be monetized there also. Of course, all this was possible with a huge amount of back-end team. And I mentioned the team here. This is a view from the roof. That is the roof of the multipurpose hall, and you see the panels that have directly been put on that. The roofing on the courtyard, which was sloped to allow for winter sun. These are the BIPV panels over here. I'm afraid when this photograph was taken, obviously maintenance was not very good. It's very dusty, but so be it. Okay, so now summing up. There is a lot of vernacular wisdom in when we talk about passive design. Most of the time when I go travel in the villages and small towns, talk to masons, they are talking about using the building, using the envelope, using the roof, using shading in ways that traditionally would suggest. Look at the buildings in a hot and dry climate. They would have thicker walls. They would be closer together to provide for mutual shading. But in order to proceed, in order to design a building today, it's important to understand the basics. So the basics of physics, the basics of heat transfer, the basics of the strategies that have to be adapted, and then how well you can integrate these strategies with the buildings that you are going to design. Common mistakes, all of us end up making them. I have, in my enthusiasm, often tended to concentrate on a strategy compromising on the function of the building or on the performance of the rest of the building. And that perhaps is something that should be avoided. In the case of Harida, for example, we were very keen to use a heat pump, and it worked out well, we detailed out everything, but the costing then made so much of a difference that we eventually had to look at a water cooled system. Eventually the water cooled system got scrapped and we came up with air cooled system. So through a series of mistakes, but finally we arrived at a system that is now working. Strategizing on cost, that again is a very important part, because eventually the client has to pay, and you've got to convince the client, you've got to make sure that it's value that the person is getting. So it's value on a capital cost basis, it's value on a running cost basis, it's value on the life cycle cost of the building. For record, the Hareda building, 55,000 square feet complete, with all fittings, with all furniture, with all systems, with the solar power plant, everything, 7-8 years ago, cost us less or a little above 2,000 rupees a square foot. Eventually, lastly, it's a question of lifestyle. Decisions that we make, choices that we have, the temperature at which we are going to feel comfortable, the car that we will drive into our office or our home, whether we are choosing to eat non-vegetarian or vegetarian. A lot of these choices are going to make a difference as to how the climate develops, and how the climate develops will be how our buildings are going to be designed. People are not talking of 1.5 degrees Celsius rise anymore. We're looking more at 4 degrees Celsius. And if it's closer to that, understand that the temperature is not going to be uniform throughout the planet. The seas will perhaps be able to mitigate the heat better. On land, these temperatures will be much higher. Are we designing? Do we have the potential to design passively for these? And do we have active or hybrid systems that can actually take care of this increased temperature? Is what we need to really look at. So thank you. And I'm open to questions now. All yours, Yashima.
Yep. So thank you so much, Siddharth. Those case studies were really great. And with all that, all those insights, I am sure our participants will have a better understanding of passive design and shading techniques. Let's take some questions now. Yes. So first is, can you talk a little bit more about time lag that you mentioned in the initial slides during in the cooling strategies?
Okay. So the way I got introduced to time lag was, how much is the time lag for a 9-inch brick wall with plaster? What is a standard fitting in all the buildings, the houses, the offices that we are in? And you realize it's about 8 to 9 hours, which means that when the peak outside temperature, the insulation, the temperature and the heat, if say on a south wall, is maximum at about 3 p.m., means that maximum heat is going to come in at about 10, 11 in the night. That's the time you are getting ready to sleep. That's not the time you want that temperature in. So to understand time lag, you need to know whether it's a cavity wall, whether it's insulation you're adding, or you're having a much thinner wall where the heat is coming in much sooner, but then is going out also. So that is how I have been using time lag.
Right. Thank you. Next question. Suppose we have a building in the context of site, which acts as a shading device. Can we rely on that building for the same?
So I didn't understand. You have a building that is being used only as a shading device.
I think they're talking about neighborhood buildings. That should we rely on neighborhood buildings for?
If it's a neighborhood building, that's free shading that you're getting. So yes. Wonderful. We should absolutely use it. Don't make a building just to provide shade. I'm sure there are easier, cheaper ways to achieve shading there. Yeah.
Right. Next, can a solar chimney be used in cold climates?
Yes, a solar chimney can be used in cold climates. See, it's important to understand, how does it work? A solar chimney is basically a thinner, taller trombe wall. You're basically using the same principle. If you're able to get good south sun, that means you're able to generate enough heat to create a flow. You should be able to use it anywhere. in the variations that I showed in a cold climate, how do you use a Trombe wall? Felix Trombe designed the wall for a cold climate. He was a French man and he was designing it for the northern climate in France. So you capture the heat, and either using a thick wall, you transfer the heat inside the building, or in case of a solar chimney, you're using it to evacuate the air. So what you can do is, rather than evacuating the air, that hot air can be used to recirculate within the space again. So you close the top of the solar chimney, you allow for that hot air to come back into the building.
Yep. Next, can you elaborate a little bit more on how to design solar chimneys? Probably some parameters that need to be considered. Yeah.
Okay. So I would say the I showed you a range of 3-4 chimneys that we worked on, and I showed you solar chimneys which were there in retreat building also. So basic principles that I have been following is, one, it needs to be thicker at the base, narrower on the top. That gives a little funneling effect to the air. Two, what I do is I normally calculate the volume of air from the rooms that has to be evacuated, and look at what you will be able to achieve in terms of air speed inside the volume. So what is the amount of heat? And normally I'm looking at about 3 meters per second kind of air that would travel through the chimney as it is getting out. So you can't err on the side of lower in this case. I prefer to err on the side of higher. Therefore, as much of heat I can get, if you look at the way the Harida chimney works, is because it's completely glass and it's then completely paneled in black metal there.
Right. Next question, can you explain how phase change material can help in humidity control?
Phase change material in humidity control. Oops, did I say that? Phase change material can work for heat. Phase change materials can be used for heat. But desiccant is what, I think I put it in the slide, but yeah, it's not right. Phase change materials would be used for heat. Heat gain and then transfer, and desiccant and using a proper material on the wall could work as a good humidity control.
Right. In slide 24, what are the points in the table? I think it was that screenshot from a book with the little dots.
So the So that book is the IIT Bombay book, and I'll just get the book and I'll show you. So the points in that are the different strategies that you can look at. So that book gives you strategies in terms of, if you're in hot and dry, then for each month, what should the strategy be? And those are not the common strategies, but the more detailed strategies that they are suggesting. So I'll just put that up and everybody can have a look.
Sure. So you want me to take another question in the meanwhile, or?
No, just do it. I'll do it at the end. It's in the studio. I'll have to start again.
Okay. So I'll move forward.
Yeah.
Okay. What are the materials of shades used in the IRRD building?
Okay. If I remember correctly, it's a kind of a fiber glass.
It's fabric, I think. Or fiberglass.
I think it's a PVC coated nylon or a PVC coated polyester fabric, so which is then stretched on top. So it's light in color, it is not heat absorbing, and but gives a shadow. Yeah. And as I said, it's a little distance away. There also is, it's important that any kind of heat gain that the surface of the building is happening is not allowed to be trapped under the shades. So it allows for free movement of air between the building and the shades.
Right. Next, can you suggest a few simulation tools to use for passive design strategies?
Oops. I'm not a great one for simulation tools. I'm sure you can answer this better, Yashima. I am more an intuitive kind of person. I don't even, I prefer a simple solar protractor to do my solar shading rather than resort to simulation. So I'll pass this one. You can suggest ways to do that.
So, so I'll actually take it up here itself. So if you are doing, if you're a very, very conceptual level, use climate consultant, you can, you know, put in your weather file and look at the climate of that particular zone. And, you know, it gives you all kinds of data. So if you want to go for ground cooling, you can look at ground temperatures, humidity, and, you know, dry bulb temperature, wet bulb temperature. And then it also gives you the percentage. So if you remember, Siddharth has also shown a psychometric chart where it was showing the percentages of so the percentage of reduction or the impact it would have. So, you know, it, that was from climate consultant, and climate consultant can give you that, you know, if you do shading, you know, you can reduce by 30%, 40% and like that. So you can prioritize based on, you know, that data. So climate consultant is actually a very handy tool, and of course it's free. So it would be good if, you know, everyone uses it. So that's one tool which you can use at conceptual design stage. Moving on to the next question, how to demonstrate savings in energy from strategies like Tromwall or solar chimney for clients or jury, as simulating them becomes quite complex?
Yes, but I think the kind of calculations that are available today, you should be able to show the kind of reduction in air conditioning load. And I think it's important to say, as a strategy, if you are able to reduce your air conditioning load, please understand that that means a drop in your capital electrical load. It means a reduction in your cable sizes. It means a reduction in your backup generators. So the saving is actually, it has a cascading effect. It's very, very important that you're looking at all these kind of little savings. Yeah, the cumulative effect is going to be far more.
Right. Next, can solar chimneys, actually there's so many questions about solar chimneys and people are quite intrigued by the concept. So can solar chimneys be worked out as hybrid with centralized AC to minimize load on air conditioning systems?
Yes, if you look at the retreat Terry building, that's what Sanjay has done. So you have a cool air ingress into the building, which is again a passive way where he's using an earth air tunnel, using it in a hybrid way because he's pushing the air in. The cold air is entering the building and the solar chimney is helping to evacuate the hot air out. So yes, that's a prime example where it can be used. So you've got to understand, if it's a purely air conditioned building, then your heat loss that will happen because of air being circulated is also going to be a lot. So you need to be careful. All the fresh air that is coming in will have its own problems, will have its own moisture that you may need to control. So you may need to end up increasing air conditioning in certain times of the year also.
Right. What thermal comfort metric was used to decide the comfort range for the Akshay Urja Bhavan?
What
thermal comfort metric? So I think this question came up when you were talking about the temperature ranges that were selected.
Yeah. So again, I would say it was a little arbitrary at that point where we were, understand that we were making this decision about 8-10 years ago. And we were looking at that if it is a range, what will be a comfortable range? And the discussion happened that, you know what, 20 to 30 seems okay. Now between 20 to 30, how do you arrive at? I'm sure, I mean, 25 plus minus 1, plus minus 3, plus minus 5 was also convenient. We were taking round figures in this case. The fact that we were able to convince the client that a range like this should be used, I think was the major victory in that.
Right. Another question. So in hot and dry climates, we can say, how can we save water while using evaporative cooling strategies?
Water will be consumed if you're evaporating. If you have a closed system, it does get a little difficult. So yes, there are ways in which evaporative coolers have been designed, where what they do is that the incoming air is in touch with a heat exchanger, which is being cooled using evaporative cooling. Do you understand that? So there is a thin metal sheet, which may be in, say, a zigzag way, in which in one direction you are putting cold, moist air. And in the other direction, you are taking the hot, dry air, which is touching the metal plate. So the hot air is not coming in contact with the moist air. So the moisture is not, the water is not being used. You are just using the cooling of the moisture. Of course, it has limitations because your wet bulb temperature is about the limit that you'll be able to achieve in this case. But it's an interesting strategy. I think it is commercially available also now.
Yep. Next question. What was the ratio of shaded areas to window sizes provided in the Akshay Urja Bhavan?
Window areas to shaded. Again, the way we were looking at was the complete south face was glazing. So other than the solar chimneys, the complete areas were glazed. We were just making sure that we were not allowing any unnecessary heat ingress as a result of those windows. The glass was also special. We used double glazing and we used a good amount of reflection, still allowing for enough VLT for the usage. So the idea was not to switch on any lights from sunrise to sunset, except for maybe some task lighting in the evening. We were able to give proper protection, and I think by and large the areas were, the window area, window wall area or the window floor area was more than what the NBC or ECBC suggests. I would say it was closer to 40% in this case.
Okay. Next, what importance would you place on water segregation at source in an efficient water management system?
I totally believe in this. We, at this time, we are doing our own residence where I am looking at ways to recycle water, and that 4 points that I gave in terms of quality, quantity, time and duration, it works not only for energy but for water as well. So say, for example, drinking water, I have a sloping part of my roof that I am concentrating cleaning, passing through a filter and then through an ordinary UV filter. We are removing the RO completely from our house. The RO, as you know, the NGT also is saying RO is no longer a preferred way of cleaning up drinking potable water. For the rest of the water, we are making sure that bathing water, washing machine water, and wash basin water is getting into a cleaning place where we are using root zone and we are using a slow sand filter in order to generate gray water, which will be used for our WCs. So the quality of water that has to be used for each function needs to be understood. Also, the source of the water. If I use
Hello? Siddharth? Yes. You're on mute.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes.
So I was saying the quality of water, not only of the end use, but the quality of the source water is also important. We were looking at how to reduce the amount of chemicals that are used in detergents in order to make the gray water easier to clean. So yes, your question of how source water needs to be understood in order for it to be properly cleaned is important. Yes, it should be understood before you can proceed.
Okay, moving on to the next question. How practical is passive design and shading in case of high rise in countries with hot and dry climate? Hello, Siddharth, are you there? Yes, you're on mute.
Okay. I was saying, have I answered that question or is there any
yes.
part left?
No, okay, no. Next question was, how practical is passive design and shading in case of high rises in countries with hot and dry climate?
I feel, if you remember the first two slides, the graph and the three-tier thing, passive is what you should be starting with. Passive is what is free. Passive is what is going to reduce the amount of hybrid or active technologies that you're going to require. So definitely passive is the preferred go-to primary strategy. In case of high-rise buildings, it will be a little difficult because shading at every level may not be possible from adjacent buildings. But you can definitely, if you look at the Apsara Academy, even on the upper floors, it's possible to use shading for the internal areas. You could have a separate wall, which is a little distance away from your primary. Look at most of the buildings coming up in the Gulf, in Oman. You will have very intricate jali patterns in FRC, which are placed, say, a few inches away from the main building. So the main heat of the sun doesn't manage to hit those, and you are able to provide a little ventilation between this barrier wall and the building there. So yes, possible, should definitely be done.
Right. Next question is, so can you give some more examples of passive techniques that can be adopted in landscape design rather than, you know, just using trees?
Okay. In terms of water control strategies, a lot of things can be done in the landscape. In terms of thermal design, trees is a good preferred way, but don't look at trees only as providing shade. Trees can be looked at to provide natural, cool, moist air also. They can also be used to prevent dust. They can also be used to control sound. So trees is or landscape is a very good, effective way to use them. Two, you can definitely use topography to your advantage. Whether you want to channelize the airflow within a campus or coming into a building can be done using natural forms there.
Next
also,
question.
You could have larger screens, for example. You could, look at the way larger screens were used, say, in Mughal buildings, where if water was flowing through them, you could have cool air as part of the landscape. You could have evaporating water as part of aesthetic features in the landscape, which would also help in controlling the heat.
Right. Next question. Can you talk a little bit more about earth coupling?
Okay. Earth coupling is basically cupping the earth, becoming one, earth berming. So you're using the lower variation in temperatures in the earth to stabilize temperatures inside. That is the basic concept. So you would have an earth bermed building where there is a wall which is touching the earth, or you could have a building that is sunken into the earth. The effect is similar, where the lower temperature variations are forming a stable thermal mass, which is generating a more comfortable, less varied temperature inside the building. There are lots of examples that you can see. If you look at the Ravinath farm, I think it's there in the Terry manual, also part one of Sanjay's and Minke's project, that uses earthworming in a very interesting way. They have a little passage on the side which collects air also, which is then used inside.
Right. So I think we are also 15 minutes past our usual time, and we'll take one last question for today.
How many more questions are there?
There are around 30 more questions. So
I am okay if you have the time. I don't mind. Take a decision. If you want me to answer these questions separately, I can do that. If we can, while it's flowing, if we can just end whatever your call, Yash. I'm okay. I'm sitting here and I would love to answer everything.
Okay, so we can continue and we'll see how it goes. So next question is insulation better than thermal mass, or is it more advisable to use thermal mass?
Okay, so this is like saying, is grossing better or is, both are different strategies. You've got to understand what is it that strategy is giving. What that insulation is giving you is that it is preventing heat transfer through that. And the quality of that material, whether it is the thickness, whether it's the U value of that, will determine how much of heat, so the depreciation, what will happen, the time lag. So the amplitude of the heat curve, how much will it be reduced by, and the time will depend on the insulation. So that is the amount of heat that is being transferred into the building. In terms of thermal mass, you can use it in other interesting ways. You can collect this heat and use it inside the building, or use the thermal mass where the heat that is coming from outside is, so this, it's basically energy that is being used in this case to heat up the mass of the building. And since the energy is being consumed in doing that, it's not being transferred inside the building. So you need to understand the difference between the two and then see how you can use it to your advantage. Each case will be different. The climatic zones will dictate the location, the size of the building, the use of the building inside. A day use building, a 24 hour building will need different strategies in this case.
Right. Next question. How much variation in the underground temperature compared to the land temperature is required for effective earth coupling techniques?
Okay. It's a rather open question. But I would say that, understand that, say, in, say, for example, Chandigarh or Delhi or Jaipur, the variation in temperature on an annual scale is nearly 40-45 degrees Celsius. We are saying that at a certain level below the earth, the temperature stabilizes to a yearly, to an annual mean. So if the annual mean is 26, the temperature 4 meters below the earth will be 26 degrees Celsius. Now in peak winter, it means that if the ambient temperature is 4-5, you're able to tap that at 26, which is nice and hot and warm and can be used free of cost. Similarly, in peak summer, the outside temperature is touching 50, you're again able to get nice, cool 26 degrees temperature for you to use. So that is how it should ideally be used, but understand 4 meters below the ground is a little difficult to get to inside the building. So that is where we need large fans in order to drive that air. And there are inherent problems because there is a certain moisture that is there. You need to put hume pipes. You need to make sure that you dehumidify. Otherwise, there will be fungus growth. A lot of times one has heard of rodents and worm in rats, whatever, managing to get in. Also, the amount of energy that is consumed just in order to use a passive technique, you end up using a fan. And just in order to make it effective, you use so much of energy to blow the air through that you may actually have achieved similar benefit by using less energy in a variety of other strategies also.
Okay. Next question. Since there is too much rainfall in warm and humid climates, how can we utilize that within the passive cooling of the building? And can we hybrid it with solar chimney? Your opinion on that?
Okay. I would say that the amount of water in hot and humid can, again, be only, I don't think you'll be able to use it for direct cooling. because your wet bulbs are not going to be within a comfortable range. What you can do is using the chimney to dehumidify and to allow for greater air movement inside the building. Your solar chimney can help you achieve that. So the moment you do that, the feeling of comfort inside the building could increase. That could be a strategy. Not using the water, but at least using the solar chimney, the heat from the sun for that.
Right. Next question. How do you deal with energy generation and consumption by using solar power panels? Solar PV panels. Can you elaborate a little more on the calculation aspect?
Oh, I'm sure you're dealing with this in some of your self-learning modules. So I just do a basic, not getting into how to calculate, but to say that the strategy should be to reduce your demand. How can you reduce demand? See, do your benchmarking. See, where is energy being used in the building? Is it being used for thermal comfort? Is it being used for lighting? Is it being used for equipment, for appliances, for whatever else? And then see what are the ways in which you can reduce. And for example, in the Harida building, we were able to bring it down to ridiculously low levels. A 55,000 square foot building, our calculation was actually 72 kilowatts installed load for the whole building. And the engineer in charge laughed at us and said, "Sir, I'm sorry, but I cannot even go and apply for this load because people will laugh at me saying, ye toh ghar ka load hota hai, ye aap puri building ka load kaise le." Anyway, we had done all our calculations and we proved that that is what we were going to achieve. He eventually went for 130 kilowatts and that's what we applied for. We applied for a generator which was much bigger, etc., etc., because lots of other considerations that come into. But yeah, so if you are able to reduce your demand, then generating is not so difficult. Again, if you can look at ways to integrate, often you see that buildings are made and then solar panels are put and then you have these funny stands that are coming in. So if you can understand that there is a slope that is required. Also, you need to understand that the slope for a solar photovoltaic is different from the slope of a solar water heater. The solar photovoltaic has to generate annually throughout the year. So it needs to be at an annual angle. While the solar water heater has to generate hot water only during winter. So it needs to be on a winter mean there. So if you can give surfaces that are already inclined to integrate these systems, it would work better.
Right. Next question. As you mentioned, the cost for the Akshay Urja building at around 2000 rupees per square feet, what are the percentage distributions in the cost in different parameters like construction cost or different techniques? Can you talk a little bit more of that, considering affordability as an aspect?
Yeah. Okay. This was, again, I don't know if I should be talking about all this in a public forum, but it was a government building. And the project management was being done by a separate government consultant. We were not directly involved with the cost. We just had to give the specifications, the drawings, and we had to supervise the building. We were told the cost at the end that this is what the whole building costs. So I'm going to stick to that, that the complete building, including furniture, including solar photovoltaics, everything was about 2,100 rupees a square foot, which I thought was amazing that we were able to achieve. At a personal thing, I will say the solar photovoltaic in those days was still quite expensive. So I would say the equipment cost of the solar photovoltaics, whatever, would be about 20%, 25% of that. The building cost was about 60%, including interiors. Furniture would be another 10, 15%, another 5%. 7% for landscape. Mota mota, that is what I would say would be the breakup.
Right. Next question. Do materials used in the solar chimney, like sealants around the glass, degrade faster than typical usage because of, you know, intense heat application of solar chimney?
Yes. Anything that you do, any passive feature, please understand that even passive features require maintenance. It's not something that you fill it, shut it, forget it. There is a little bit of personal involvement that is important. Yes, so we've been using better grade sealants. You're able to get UV resistant sealants also. So you're able to seal with that. Initially, we started doing with putty. That doesn't hold. So a better quality sealant. Most of the glazing that you see today in all the buildings is fitted with those sealants. So the black polysulfide sealant that you see is what is used. That is very good in this case. Inside, what we've used is also stone. We've used just a brick or a plaster which is painted black. We've also used metal. I would say a metal which is painted matte black would work well.
Okay. Next question. How did you ensure that natural ventilation in the toilets? So this is a question related to the Hareda building. How did you ensure that natural ventilation in toilets was happening on the south side? Do the toilet store have doors have permanent openings?
Yes. So what we did was that it was an open toilet. The ladies and the gents was an open toilet. There was one main door and the duct was running above the door into the common area. And that was connected into the solar chimney directly. So we had an opening on the north face of the building, which was the toilet wall, which was a permanent ventilation opening. And all the cubicles, the top of the cubicles were much lower. So we're at 7 feet and the building was going up to 10 feet. Therefore, we were able to evacuate the air from there.
Right. Next question. In case of, again, the Hareda building, why are the windows on the east and west facade made to face towards the south direction? Wouldn't there be more heat gain from south?
Okay. It's important to first understand why we didn't want windows on the east and west. The angle of the sun is much lower and therefore gets difficult to control. The advantage of having a window facing south is that just by a horizontal shade, you are able to achieve keeping the summer sun out, allowing winter sun to come. It's just a horizontal shade. If you've done your basic solar geometry, you'll know that. Therefore, for us, it made sense that the east and west windows were, so we had reflective tiles on the outer surface and we were making them face south so that with just a shade, we were able to control the summer sun. Still allowing for winter sun to come in. And of course, there was light, natural light that was coming in at all.
Right. Another question about the Hareda building. Now, the roof louvers used for the project were cladded with aluminium panels. Wouldn't that prove to be a good conductor of heat? Especially, you know, when the summer sun, where maximum heat gain is through the roof. So...
Okay. Yeah. So again, a lot of thought went into this. The first idea was that yes, we need louvers so that the courtyard becomes shaded during summer. In winter, we still wanted. We were wanting a lot of activity inside the courtyard. We wanted people to come and sit there in winter, eat their lunch there. It didn't happen because of a policy that Hareda had. We wanted people to go out, not sit inside. We eventually decided on ACP panels, and these were silver colored ACP panels. So there was very little heat gain that was actually happening. Understand that the ACP panel also has a filler, which is a rubberized layer. So it's thin layers of aluminium on the outside. And therefore, there was not much heat gain. The idea was that if there is some bit of heat gain in summer, it will make the top of the courtyard hot, which means that the hot air will rise and will allow for the cool air to go through. Since the louvers were also open, it was aiding that. So it was not a difficult decision. We still felt that it would work. If you look carefully in the photographs, you will see that there are some down fans which are suspended from the louvers also. Those were meant to increase the circulation of the misting, of the fogging that we were doing inside.
Right. So Siddharth, those were the questions that we had. The rest of the questions are more administrative and, you know, competition related, which we will take care of at a later stage. And so with that, we come to the end of this session today. I would like to thank the Department of Science and Technology and all our sponsors and affiliates for their support. Siddharth, thank you so much for this very informative session. The Q&A in particular was very helpful, and we hope that our participants can make the best use of the knowledge and the practices that you have shared today. Thank you everyone once again for participating so actively. See you next week for the...
If I can just say that if there are further questions, if people need further clarifications, I'm sure. There, you can email either through you or directly, whatever, email me and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Sure. So if you have more questions related to this particular topic, you can send in to us and, you know, we can direct them to Siddharth. And we will see you next week for the natural ventilation webinar. Goodbye and good luck for the upcoming submission.